About 1,000 Cubans gathered within sight of the U.S. intersection in Havana, yelling Cuba see, Yankees know. They urged the U.S. in speech and song to return young Elian Gonzalez to Cuba.
As I was packing for Cuba in December 1999, demonstration in Havana began to appear on television. Watching Cubans grimly held flags, marching in large platoons, made me a little concerned. The only thing I knew was, I'm about to enter a country that has been the United States enemy for 40 years, a place that is forbidden to American travelers, and one of the last standing communist nations in the world. The original premise of this trip was to document a group of doctors studying the Cuban healthcare system. However, the intense political standoff of the time delivered some unexpected events. We witnessed for ourselves what television viewers don't get to see, Cuba from within.
From a town in southeastern North Carolina called Wilmington, a beautiful little place on the coast. And I am a chiropractic physician with a lifelong interest in Latin America. And I suspect that secretly I really wish I were a 19th century explorer who could go all the places no one else has gone and find out things that no one else knows yet. But since that's not exactly in the cards right now, I figure coming to Cuba was the next best thing. It was interesting, especially because of the current situation with the little boy, Elian. I didn't know how much hostility we were going to face as being Americans from the United States. And I didn't know whether we were going to be subject to any sort of problem with respect to demonstrations. The people on the exchange assured me that that we were here at the invitation of the Cuban government and that there really wouldn't be any problems. And I sort of believed that, but emotionally, I wasn't sure. So when we stepped off the plane at José Martí Airport, I was looking for the guys carrying the submachine guns. And, I didn't see any. And I thought, well, this is, so far so good. Passport control was interesting. A little bit more militaristic than I'm used to, but once again, no submachine guns in evidence. And I thought it was kind of prophetic after moving through the passport line where another official stopped me and asked me what I was doing here. So obviously I'm not a man at a loss for words, and I started telling him about alternative medicine and wellness care and what we were doing, studying all of that, and I saw his eyes glaze over, and I thought, boy, that's a great sign. This guy's bored. He doesn't want to know. He doesn't want to know any of the particulars about any of this.
The first activity after we arrived was biking Havana. This trip was led by Ignacio Valladares Rivero, a former university professor and the current president of the Grand Caribe Bicycle Club. He and the other members of the team harnesses a batch of cross-hybrid bicycle to a rig system that took some time to assemble, and then bike for 2 hours to the hotel for our leisure. Human power is the most reliable source of energy in Cuba. On the return, while passing along the Malecón, we encounter a magnificent sunset. The U.S. intersections appear in our view. There were signs, banners, and flags, draped in desolation near an empty stage, but no one was around. This site earlier was the gathering spot of a large demonstration, mainly aimed at the camera crew. But then, when the sun settled and the dust fell, peace was imminent. On our first night in Havana, a small group of us set out to discover the nightlife in Cuba. During our excursion, we met Eduardo and Yamila, two young Cubans in their 20s. They became our guides. Jeremy Schaefer, a young American in the group, was our ambassador since he could handle more Spanish than any of us. He was also quite an entertainer. Jeremy proved to be the center of attention as the night went on, when he demonstrated his exceptional skills.
Soy de origen cubano. Primeramente, saludos para mi madre, Mercedes, en Cuba. Y aquí me ven en Malecón compartiendo con los amigos americanos. Aquí estamos bajo una situación sobre el secuestro del niño Elian Gonzalez, que apoyamos.
¡Viva Elian!
Apoyamos muy vigorosamente la actitud del pueblo cubano sobre ese niño secuestrado. Sabemos que ese niño va a ser devuelto a nuestro país más tarde o más temprano, y como siempre el gobierno imperialista siempre quiere oponerse, siempre pone obstáculos, pero sabemos que nosotros vamos a triunfar, porque la moral del pueblo cubano es mundialmente por encima de ellos, aunque ellos sean imperialistas, sean poderosos, pero nosotros vamos a triunfar. Chao.
While walking along the hotel corridor, I heard beautiful music drifting along. As I approach it, a group of musicians appear in the corner of the patio playing to a crowd of a few. This band, Secreto Rumi, was one of many six-piece orchestra roaming the streets of Havana. Secreto Rumi members have a steady job playing at the Copacabana Hotel for the tourists. They often croon tiresome tunes requested by the hotel guests, such as Guantanamera or Che Guevara. Each member of the band received a salary of $7 a month. Because of the economic hardship, Cuba catered heavily to the tourism industry. All precious goods and services are devoted to the dollar carrying guests. For ordinary Cubans like Secreto Rumi, the goods reserved for the tourists were simply unaffordable. It takes 2 monthly salaries for a band members to purchase a meal at the Copacabana buffet line.
Nichiswa Vaskiawo, Chicago, Illinois.
How old are you, Matthew?
How old? 82.
That's young.
Yeah. I'm 82.
What are you doing here in Cuba?
What am I doing in Cuba?
Uh-huh.
My third visit.
Your third visit?
My third visit now, and about four visits with Batista.
Really?
Really. But I like Fidel Castro much, much better.
Why?
Well, because I met him in 93. Uh-huh. We stood in line to shake hands, and I refused to shake hands. I gave him a hug and a kiss. My little cheek. I did. That's my highlight of my life. As I said in the introducing ourselves, that I believe in music, dancing, and sexing.
Sexing?
Sexing. Have a lot of good sex at 82.
My girlfriend yesterday, the day before.
No kidding. Wow.
I'm gonna confront him on it. And just say, do you have anything to say to me? She was going up to take a bath or a shower, and he said, let me take a bath with you. And she said, no. 2 years ago, I roomed with a guy who told two young women in our group that he had been downtown with two men from the group in Havana and picked up a prostitute, took her to dinner. He would have f***ed her, but he said she was so hungry, she was eating the chicken and the grease was all over her face. That turned him off. So the two women told me, and that night I said, you know, they told me what you did, and if I were leader of this group, you'd be on your way home right away. You'd be out of here.
Wow.
Well, so every once in a while, you find an asshole in this group. Not many.
Right.
I've met three people in five trips. That's among 500 people or 600 people. Three is not bad.
I'm 41 years old, living in Havana. That's where I was born. I used to work as a teacher in a high school in the country. I was teaching teenagers during 7 years. And during 7 years working as a teacher. And now I'm working as a musician in the Copacabana Hotel. So a few days ago, we received in the hotel a group of American people bringing friendship to our people, bringing the peace. And I think the reason of his coming is very important for the relationship between the people of Cuba and United States.
What do you think of the alien situation?
I think it is a stupid law by the American government, because they have no right to kidnap the child. They have no law to control this. Because his parents live here, and the boy was born here. So
they have no rights. I think they would come to hear the reality in Cuba, you know? That's the reason of the coming of the group. Just arrived here at the hotel. To know Cuban people, to talk with the people, to change experiences between the population and so on.
A few days later, the delegation visited Matanza, a region nearby. While there, the official invited the group to Marcelo Salado, the school that Elian Gonzalez attended in Cadenas. This trip was extra special because of an unscheduled event. Little did the group realize that they were going to meet the future hero of Cuba on that day, Juan Miguel Gonzalez. The father of the displaced boy made an appearance at the town museum that dedicated to his son. At the press conference, the place was filled with town people, officials, young kids, and posters of Elian. After the ceremony, Marianne Malloy, an attorney from Minnesota, asked Elian's father some questions.
Elian's mother was going to be leaving Cuba?
He had no idea that any of this was going to happen.
Have you had communication with the people who have Elian living in their home at this time?
He ha comunicado con la persona que ya tiene Elian en su casa.
Sí, he hablado con ellos, he hablado con el niño. Todos los días lo llamo, como eso.
Yeah, he's talked with him. Talked with him on the phone.
Every day.
How does he feel right now?
¿Cómo siente Elian ahora? ¿Cuáles son sus sentimientos de...?
Bueno, figúrese extrañando mucho aquí, preguntando por la escuela, por la maestra, por sus compañeros, que le empieza a faltar lo material de él, no lo material, sino lo espiritual, el deseo de estar junto a su familia.
He's asking about all of his friends, about his home, about his family and everything like that. And they're, you know, showing him a good time, but he's still asking about everything going on here.
Is he asking you when he can come home?
Está pidiendo información de cuándo puede regresar.
Estoy esperando que den respuesta.
Yeah, he's waiting the answer.
Okay, do you know the people that he's staying with?
¿Usted conoce a la
persona que está con él?
Sí, son familiares míos.
Are you represented by any attorney that's taken your petition into a Florida court?
¿Tiene abogado en Florida que está actuando en su parte?
¿Tiene un abogado en Estados Unidos que está actuando para que regresen al niño a Cuba?
¿Y lo está representando?
Los abogados que tengo son aquí en Cuba. 11 millones de abogados tengo. Pueblo de Cuba completo.
Would you accept representation by an attorney that would represent you in the Florida court requesting that the child be turned over to an agent of yours?
Para que el niño se devuelva.
No es necesario, porque eso no tiene necesidad ninguno.
It's necessary because there is only need to have an attorney there because he has the right to have the child back to Cuba.
I understand that you have a right. Are you aware that the laws in the United States say that before a court can have jurisdiction in a child custody matter, they must determine where the child lived for the last year, and if the child did not live in that jurisdiction, the court does not have jurisdiction?
Well, this is a long explanation.
Yeah.
Es lo que está diciendo, que si tú conoces las leyes de Estados Unidos sobre los niños que están allá, el problema es que, well, this is not the legal law of the United States. This is the right he has for the child to be with him. And this is according with Cuban law, not according with the law of the United States.
Okay, but the immigration law can be subject to politics, but the law of Florida, I believe, will not. And the law of Florida says...
Está hablando sobre las leyes en la Florida.
Okay. Las leyes en cualquier lugar del mundo son las mismas.
Bueno, but he says that the law in relation with the child, the right of the children to have with the parents, and he is the parents, and all the rest of the child, the rest of the family of the child, here. Well, of course. Thank you. Gracias, gracias.
Gracias por todo.
After the short exchange, we made our way to Elian School. As we entered through the gate, the place erupted. In its heydays, Cadenas held great stakes in the U.S. interests. Many sugar plantations were owned by wealthy Americans. In a 19th century diary, an author described it as a place that makes a Yankee feel at home. Since the Cuban Revolution in 1959, Cadenas slowly retreated into the shadow of obscurity and disappeared from the international recognition. However, within the month of the new millennium, its name reappeared in the news due to one of its lost citizens. In the United States, Elian became news headlines.
For 4 months now, governments have been arguing, lawyers have been wrangling, judges have been issuing pronouncements, all about a little boy who has remained the silent center of a storm. He is, of course, six-year-old Elian Gonzalez, the child whose mother drowned, and then he floated through the ocean 2 days in an inner tube before his rescue and the international tug of war over his future. We have just spent 2 days with Elian. The Cuban government, you should know, denounced us for interviewing a child without the permission of his father in Cuba. Fair enough. And we know that his uncles and cousins in Miami who invited us down have their own agenda as well. They hope Elian's face and words will increase public pressure on their side, and they may not be satisfied with us either. But we wanted to tell you how we came to our decision. You should know that we debated long and hard about meeting Elian. And here's why we decided to go ahead. Because the U.S. government is now increasing a drumbeat of talk about his immediate return to Cuba, and yet no one in the U.S. government has met with the child, and no one seems to be talking about how to do it in a way that is sensitive to him. And even though the media has had him under 20-hour-a-day surveillance and written, by our calculation, 11,984 articles about the politics of all this, not one of us has sat down and looked into his eyes. The first day, we pretty much just got to know each other. But on the second day, at the suggestion of Dr. Perdigo, we spent some time drawing to see what Elian might want to tell us. I drew the island of Cuba. Elian quickly joined in.
Can you?
He tells me I've drawn Cuba too small.
And is there a tree on this island too?
¿Tiene un árbol en esta isla?
Yeah.
¿Cómo? ¿Te vas a ayudarla?
Like that?
Look.
No.
Like
And suddenly, on another sheet, some waves.
Is that the water?
A dolphin. Himself in an inner tube. He draws a boat.
What happened to this boat?
¿Qué se pasó con ese barco?
Water came in, he says.
And who's this?
Me, he said. I was sinking. I have not heard anyone doubt that Elian's father loves him, but I have heard people wonder endlessly about one thing. How is it that his father did not get on the next plane? Somebody said they would swim, if that's what it took, to be with Elian when he was in the hospital the day after he arrived.
Aquí estamos y aquí nos quedamos. Y abajo la migra. La migra a la basura.
Why he don't come here and get the point? Why he don't come to the United States? Why? Because maybe that idiot Castro, he don't want him to come over here. You know why? Because maybe he think that he's gonna stay here. That's why. That's what I'm thinking, you know? Why his father he don't come? What the, you know what I mean? Think about it. Well, if his father need his kid with him, I come and get my son. I do everything what I can, you know, to come to this country and get my son for myself. I don't need to bring my her grandma or whatever. He's the one who's supposed to come here and get his son.
Who? The father?
His father.
You know, if he comes here, they'll kill him.
Why?
They will, take my word for it. If he comes to Miami, they will kill him. You know why? Because these people, these gusanos, worms in Miami, they are criminals. They are mercenary, they are sellouts, they are gangsters, they are thugs. They will kill him. Take my word. They already killed about 5 newspaper men in Miami. If you don't go along with them, if you dissent, they'll kill you. Pure and simple. If this boy, if the man goes to Miami, get his son, he will be shot, he will be killed. That's a fact.
Claro.
No. Yo soy nicaragüense también, yo soy sandinista también. Yo soy de Estelí. Que viva Nicaragua libre. Que viva Sandino. Que viva Sandino. Que viva el Frente Sandinista de Liberación Nacional. Aquí está. Gusano. Vende patria. Aquí está. Sandina vivo, Sandino.
This morning, the father of 6-year-old Elian Gonzalez lands in Washington. Now it's a showdown for his son. Wake up, Los Angeles. It's Thursday morning, April 6th. I'm David Ono.
4 months after the short encounter with the American visitors in Cardenas, Juan Miguel Gonzalez came to America to retrieve his son.
2 weeks have passed, and I am still not with my son. And it hurts me to see what they are doing with my son and the abuse they are submitting him to. I please ask that you call by phone, that you write letters, that you do everything you can to help. My son is only 6 years old. He is a child like any other American child. He is no different. I ask all people who have feeling and really know what it is to know the love between a father and son Don't let politics dominate this. It is simply a father and a son. Help me.
Less than 2 hours later, President Clinton weighed in.
First of all, I think he should be reunited with his son. That is the law. And the main argument of the family in Miami for not doing so has now been removed. I mean, their main argument was, if we let him go back to his father before the court rules, he might go back to Cuba. The court has now said he shouldn't go back to Cuba. The Justice Department agrees with that, and he has agreed to that.
I think the boy's father ought to be coming to the United States, you bet, and to be able to make a decision in freedom as to where his son ought to be.
While the opinion on whether aliens should stay or go back to Cuba varied on both sides, the one that appeared on the poll mattered the most.
It happened at 5:14 this morning with a suddenness that was stunning. Three vans pulled up and out poured heavily armed federal agents, spraying mace and tear gas at the small crowd of bewildered protesters. A team of agents broke through the front door of the Miami relative's home and rushed in. Donato Dalrymple, one of the two fishermen who rescued Elian last Thanksgiving Day, was hiding in a closet with Elian clutched in his arms. An INS agent brandishing an automatic weapon demanded that he hand over the boy.
And I didn't want to give the boy. I said, you can't take him. And they just put the guns and he said, move, give us the boy.
5:16 a.m. A female Immigration Service agent wrapped a blanket around Elian and took him in her arms and raced out to a waiting van. Elian was crying. 5:17 a.m. The protesters outside, now fully aware of what was happening, began to erupt, hurling boxes and chairs at retreating agents. The entire operation took less than 3 minutes. No one was...
This is not the United States of America. This is Bill Clinton's legacy. This is Bill Clinton's America. A-M-E-R-I-K-A, Uberales.
I just don't know. I think that Fidel's a nice guy, and he loves children, and they have free health care. Even though if it's a rusty nail and a dirty scalpel, it's still free. Bill Clinton's whole agenda, this is, Bill Clinton doesn't care about these people. Bill Clinton doesn't even care about the Cuban people. Bill Clinton is trying to normalize relations for his own ego at the expense of these people. This is all about liberalism and enhancing the liberal agenda in this country. This is what Bill Clinton's all about. And another thing, some of you in the media, CNN, ABC, CBS, NBC, you are also accomplices in this affair. You media have portrayed the Cuban exile community in a very negative light. You're in bed with the Clinton administration. Shame on you. Shame on you.
How did it happen that this particular unaccompanied minor, this particular story in this particular year became such a big deal?
Well, I think, Ray, the big problem that we have in America today still, and among ourselves in the mass media, it's a problem, is that we turn some of these human tragedies into soap opera news spectacles, more to sometimes entertain the American people than to really educate them. And I think that this was another example, whether you can go from O.J. to Monica, now it's Elian. And I think that the reality was that in an election year, the arrival of Elian on Thanksgiving Day touched off a debate not only about family values that the American people hold dear versus the continuing fight of the Cold War against Castro, but it also raised issues in terms of how our country continues to regard Cuba very differently, even from other socialist countries like China or Vietnam or Korea, and why that is. And I think all of these things came to the fore in this election year.
Me trae como consecuencia muchas limitaciones.
dinero, mi trabajo, condiciones para trabajar, medicamentos para mi vida, para mi familia, alimentación, diversión, de todo lo que pueda necesitar un humano para vivir. Te hablo humanamente como un ciudadano de este mundo que sufre en carne propia un embargo económico hace más de 40 años. Ahora yo preguntaría al gobierno de Estados Unidos, si Elian fuera africano, fuera mexicano, fuera hondureño, fuera vietnamita, ¿qué pasaría con Elian? Nada, porque realmente aceptan esa salida clandestina de los cubanos por un problema político. Entonces, desde acá, yo lo pregunto a Clinton, a su presidente, que ¿por qué Cuba? ¿Por qué con Cuba? ¿Por qué con el Capitolio Habanero? ¿Y por qué con los hijos de La Habana? Que jamás le hemos hecho nada. Sin el bloqueo, podíamos tener una amistad profunda, fraternal, de hermanos, porque no importa el idioma que hablemos, sino cómo pensemos y la idea que tengamos. Y cada quien hace con su soberanía lo mejor que le parezca. Así piensa Cuba, así pienso yo, y así somos los cubanos. Y gracias a ti por venir con el objetivo, por cumplir tu objetivo, y ojalá que se repita tu visita. Mil gracias.
Al amanecer, y en la primavera, segunda, tercera, mira bonito, los flamantes cantar, con los truenos, deseando siempre estar, enseñando tu luz. Al anochecer, el bosque es bonito, y se ha de querer.
I know in seeing the country, you know they need money, but the passion that they've had for taking care of their people for 40 years in the basics, the rights of people to live, to medical, housing, and education are the main things. And they still feel passionate about providing those to the people. Hopefully, I'm scared for the
and also in
for the future. Marvin
theater,
didn't like that word, so scared, but I'm scared that that you know, one wrong decision or a few wrong decisions will take them back to their pre-days that they didn't like. I'm scared of that, and I don't mind using that word because I think it can happen.
Thank you.
music and dance, that spirit of the people that just goes forward despite all the hardships. They just keep trucking along, kind of like Fidel Castro himself. So, on the trip, we went to a lot of discotecas. Well, that's my personal interest, dancing salsa a lot. And I just felt that the people, there's an incredible sense of community there. Everybody knew each other and accepted us as community, and we'd do in the middle of the dance, we do the train where everybody holds each other's back, and the whole discoteca is doing this train, and that's something that doesn't happen here really. But I also saw a great level of frustration in the people in the dual economy that they've had to bear, and I felt even though I was a friend, because I'm breaking the embargo by coming, I felt that there was just resentment towards America so strong that it was hard to even separate the good guys from the bad guys from their point of view. That, I mean, here's Americans, they have dollars and we don't have dollars, and so I felt this just really touching feeling of just helplessness for me and for them. They just couldn't buy just everyday items like medicine, shoes, clothing. They were in a very difficult situation, and I had the means, and yet I couldn't really help them. I mean, I didn't want to just suddenly start throwing dollars in the air. I didn't think that would help. Like an example, I was at a discotheque and just to dance with people, they would expect, oh, well, I'm a tourist, therefore, whatever, if they dance with me, I should pay them, that kind of thing. Or this guy would dance just right in front of me, like doing this incredible footwork, and then he said, look, I just showed you that, now here, could you please pay me? And I was just like, what? I don't think so.
That's piano.